Hi, Rookie. I'm George, aka Twin Shadow. I am here with John Green, author of Fault in Our Stars, author of Paper Towns, the movie that is coming out. And he's also a vlogger. I'm here with him because I wanted to talk about a few things we have in common, just have a conversation. I'm lucky enough to have my song To the Top in the end credits of this movie. We're just gonna have a chat.
I was curious about, reading the book, I really understood and felt an attachment with Florida, because I spent 17 years in Florida. And I wondered how long you actually lived in Florida.
I lived there from the time I was 3 until I was 15 when I went to boarding school.
So you have Florida in your blood.
Yeah, I mean, definitely. Like, I grew up, in Orlando, looking up at the airplanes that flew over my house 400 times a day and thinking all of these people are coming here or leaving here, and right. I am the only one staying.
Right.
Where did you live?
I lived in Tampa Bay.
Okay, yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's, I feel like Miami kind of gets an exemption. But yeah, Orlando and Tampa are legit Florida.
Yeah, it's funny because I constantly argue with people about whether Florida is the South or not. And I always say, it's not only is it definitely the South, it is the South with alligators and bikinis.
Yeah, I mean, it's a fascinating culture. Like, I've since sort of reconciled myself to Orlando, I think, and like, I think wherever you grow up, you want to leave. Like, I think, or at least that's been my experience.
Ambitious.
Yeah, you know, like, I want my kids to grow up in Indianapolis in part so that they're so desperate to go. Right. I always did want to leave Orlando, and I always hated it, and I hated going to Disney World, and I would just sit at the Hall of Presidents for 8 hours while everyone else was off riding rides, and I would, like, just, like, sit there and make fun of everything and write in my little notebook. And right. But I don't know. I mean, I'm very grateful to have grown up in Orlando in a lot of ways because it's a very American place.
Yeah. That was kind of leads perfectly into my next question for you, which was, I feel the same way. I have slowly become more and more grateful of the fact that I grew up there because it did teach me about my own ambition and getting out of some place that I found incredibly boring. And when I read the book, Margot really is so over it. And,
yeah.
And I did wonder, much like how she does know how to find the magic, I think appreciating Florida as part of that is about finding kind of the magic in living there. And I was curious what your kind of the most magical things about Florida, because I have my own.
Yeah, I mean, for me, there's something about the heat in Orlando. There's something about just the way that it feels that is always going to feel like home to me. The way that, like, summertime feels, and you're climbing up an orange tree and you're stealing oranges. That's always going to be a particular feeling for me. And then the other thing is which I did put in the book is. These empty subdivisions, these places where they laid out the streets and you can see the cul-de-sacs, and some of them even have mailboxes. And I just loved walking around those places with my friends when I was a kid. I just felt like I was exploring an abandoned world. I felt like the world had been abandoned and now it belonged just to us. There's a great line in a Mountain Goats song. We were the one thing in the galaxy God didn't have his eyes on. And I felt like that a lot in Orlando when I was a kid. Like, I could be the one thing in the galaxy that God didn't have his eyes on.
Yeah, that's amazing. I share so many of the same feelings. All my friends were skateboarders, and
yeah.
So that was kind of the greatest thing. All this abandoned stuff.
Right, it's great for skateboarding.
Amazing skateboarding.
Yeah,
and also like nighttime skateboarding, because if the moon was out,
yeah.
Then you'd have amazing light reflected off brand new paved surfaces.
Right.
And it was just kind of like you kind of got to put on like these weird Florida night vision goggles.
Yeah, I mean, I remember the way the moon like lit up the night, and night's so comfortable.
Yeah.
You know, like it's the only time it's really comfortable.
And warmth. Yeah,
it's still and it's warm. And again, like for me, like I felt like the world was made for us in those times. Like we were the people, we were the only people out. And like this, it was our town at night, and it was our town. You know, like those little abandoned subdivisions were ours. And when you're a kid, like a lot of times you can't feel like much is yours. You know, there's not much that belongs to you. And so those are special memories for me.
Do you listen to music while you write?
I can't do it while I'm writing. Do you?
I've been thinking about this forever. I have friends who can listen to music while they, like.
Even if they're hearing a different melody?
While they write. No, they listen, I mean, while they
write. Oh, like writing prose.
Yeah, writing prose.
Yeah.
And I've never been able to do it because it's always distracting.
Yeah, I can listen to it before. And I usually do listen to music before. I don't usually listen to it during. When I wrote my book, The Fault in Our Stars, one of the characters is a big fan of Swedish hip hop, and I sort of temporarily became pretty immersed in the world of Swedish hip hop.
Okay.
It's a sort of method acting. And I could listen to Swedish hip hop because it wasn't that distracting.
Right. So would you write to like instrumental music?
Maybe. That's what I don't know. But even like, because I feel like the emotions don't always match where I need to be mentally in the story. You know, that's the. Yeah.
Because I've been wondering for a while now if. Or what about the other way around? What about when you read? Can you listen to music?
No.
Right.
No.
Me neither.
I'm not a good multitasker in that way. Like. I need to be, one of the things I like about reading actually is that I can't do anything else while I'm doing it, you know? Like everything else, like I can play Angry Birds on my phone and listen to music. I can, you know, I can do almost anything and listen to music. I can watch TV and check Twitter at the same time. Like one of the things I love about reading is that for me, like it's immersive. You don't have a choice except to pay attention.
Right, creating the voices in your head is so key.
Yeah, you've got to be able to kind of like listen to the words.
I tried for a second to, like, I had an Audible account.
Yeah.
Mostly because I wanted to read Bram Stoker's Dracula,
But you didn't want to read it.
Yeah, I didn't want to read it, exactly.
I'm totally sympathetic.
And I didn't want to really watch the movie because Gary Oldman's the only thing I like about it.
Yeah.
I tried to get this Audible account, and it was just like, you know, constantly.
Yeah, you just get distracted so quickly.
Yeah, and I realized how important it is to create voices in your head while you're reading.
Yeah, I once listened to, the time I've listened to the most audiobooks, I signed 155,000 copies of The Fault in Our Stars before it came out, and it was fun. I have OCD, so it was nice. I liked it. It did something unhealthy to me. But I listened to The Adventures of Augie March, the Saul Bellow novel, and I listened to like the first like 8 hours of it, and then I was like, I have to read the book.
Right.
So it was good as like getting me into the book like a hook.
Right.
So like it got me through the first like 150 pages where I was into it. I was into all the characters, but then I was like, I need the book.
Right. Yeah. Cool. So I noticed you have the This Machine Kills Fascists sticker on
Yeah, from Woody Guthrie's laptop. Guitar, yeah.
And I was thinking about, I know when the kids go to Margot's room, they're kind of like, they have no idea who Woody Guthrie is. And I know most of my peers actually have no idea who Woody Guthrie is.
Yeah.
And I think about kind of old, humble heroes like that. And how I was thinking about the story of Bob Dylan going to meet Woody Guthrie and finding him kind of not well.
Yeah, late in the
season. And when I read about it, he almost had this kind of. I think the journey of getting to Woody Guthrie was important, but the actual meeting maybe didn't have the effect that he wanted it to. I wondered about you while I read through your stuff. Do you have heroes and idols who you've met or who you'd like to meet, or more so, do you have heroes and idols who you've met who've disappointed you, or have you had the opposite experience?
I definitely have people I don't want to meet. you know, I don't want to meet Toni Morrison. Just want to leave that there with me thinking about her novels and thinking about them being, you know, like the most important books to me, and I don't want to mess with that relationship that I have built over like 15 years by a real person entering it, you know? But usually I've found that the people I really admire are really cool in real life. I know that that sometimes a lot of, you know, like deeply unhappy or dysfunctional people make beautiful art and make good stuff. But I mean, the biggest hero I've ever met in real life is the lead singer of the Mountain Goats, and I was super nervous, but he was really cool.
Right.
And we've just kind of become friendly. And usually people, I think the truth is, like, if you think about people as more than people, they're always going to disappoint you, because when you romanticize or idealize people, like, that's just a different way of dehumanizing them. And, and ultimately, like, they're going to disappoint you because they're going to be human and they're going to be flawed. But if you cannot put that expectation on them, I don't know. I mean, you know what it's like to meet people who really admire you and who are big fans of you. And it's always an interesting challenge, because you want to, or at least like when that happens to me, like, I really want to express my very genuine gratitude to them for allowing my work into their lives and for making use of it and all that stuff. But at the same time, like, it's very difficult for it to feel like a peer relationship, because you know, they know much more about me than I know about them, and also because, you know, they're coming to this experience from a fan perspective and not from a peer perspective.
Right. Yeah, they have total expectation.
And
you have, really? Well, thank you.
And you don't know how, it's almost impossible to say thank you. I mean it, but it's almost impossible to say thank you in a way that sounds, that expresses what I'm trying to express, and I still don't really know how to navigate that.